let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. That where I am, there ye may be also. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more. But ye see, because I live, ye shall live also. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, wherever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting,
that you have done.
Thou art God.
Look at him and tell him, yes, I'm grateful.
For a thousand years in thy sight, are but as yesterday when it is past,
tell him I
and as a watch in the night. So teach us to number our
about
days,
your works,
that we may apply our hearts,
because I'm grateful,
unto wisdom.
Because I'm grateful, grateful, so grateful, just
to praise you, Lord. Lift your hands and say, flowing from my heart.
Oh, satisfy us early with thy mercy, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Let thy work appear unto thy servants, and thy glory unto their children. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us. Establish thou the work of our hands upon us. Yea, the work of our hands establish thou.
Grateful, 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 grateful.
Draw nigh to God.
Grateful, grateful,
he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners. And purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. Let your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. That where I am, there ye may be also. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me. Because I live, ye shall live also. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. We would not have you ignorant, brethren, concerning those who are asleep, that ye may not grieve as others do when who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, shall not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the archangels called, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words.
You could have left me outdoors. Oh, I'm grateful. I said it should have been me. It should have been me. It could have been me. But I'm grateful.
Another witness tonight. Come in, Dave Hollister. Oh, yeah.
I don't know where to start, Jesus. God, I could have been dead and gone, but you saw so different. You decided to save me. Oh, and I'm grateful. Oh, and I'm grateful.
We are indeed grateful for the life of Mrs. Willie Mae Patrick. We welcome you to this celebration of life. Mrs. Willie Mae Patrick, sunrise December 3rd, 1926. Sunset April 13th, 2021. Here at Ashdale Cemetery. I am Pastor DJ Manuel of Greater Friendship Missionary Baptist Church, and I am just delighted to have the opportunity to share with you all in this home-going celebration. And I say it's a celebration because I know that she believed in the risen Savior. And so I can celebrate because I know though I may miss her now, I will see her again. And that is the hope we want to impart to you today. We are going to follow the program as it is printed with one or two adjustments. We're going to begin with the Old and New Testament scriptures given by Reverend Dr. C.P. Noble, the pastor of Greater St. Mark Missionary Baptist Church, and we're going to have prayer by Reverend Richard Cloud, one of the associates at Greater Friendship Missionary Baptist Church, and they will come in that order.
Our Old Testament scripture will come from Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Our New Testament scripture will be from Revelation chapter 14. And verse 13. And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. The word of God for the people of God.
Let us pray. Our Father, we come in the name of your Son, Jesus, ask you to bless right now, uplift this family. We pray, Father, that you would strengthen them. Then, Father, build them up where they may be weak. In times like these, Father, we need you all, every minute and every hour, to strengthen us, Father, as we travel this journey. Bless them now, Master. Keep them uplifted in these trying times. We pray, Father, for all of our guests around, all members and friends. We pray that God will keep you going along this journey. Then, Father, when we come to the end of our journey, we pray that you would receive our souls into thy kingdom, that we can evermore praise thee. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Thank you, Dr. Noble and Reverend Cloud. We have an opportunity right now for expressions by Dr. Barry Williams. And when Dr. Williams is completed, we have a resolution to be shared by former Mayor Johnny Ford.
Good morning, everyone. First, I want to give glory to God. And also, I would like to let you know I'm honored to be here today because I'm honoring a great person. Me and Mrs. Patrick were friends, and we were family. She was my mother. That's where she was. Coach Patrick, you challenged me. You told me to try to stay down to 3 minutes. I'm going to try, so you and Mook, don't jump on me if I go up, okay? Please, I beg you. And you too, Robert, okay? But anyway, I love Mrs. Patrick because that's what she was. She was a mother and a friend to me. And you've all heard the phrase, it takes a village to raise a kid. Well, I first met Mrs. Patrick many years ago. I had finished school, and I wanted to start in residence life. I figured that was a good area to start for student affairs. Well, Mrs. Patrick was a veteran there. She was the director for the custodial and maintenance service for the Honors Hall where I worked, and she raised me. because you know at the beginning of a school year, Mrs. Patrick, Belinda Patrick, you know this, you have to get the halls ready. She helped me get the halls ready and maintenance, and when you have parents coming in. So she raised me. She taught me how to run a residence hall, and I owe it to Mrs. Patrick for that reason. Also, I called Mrs. Patrick. One time I confused Mrs. Patrick. She had had a bad day at work, and I called at home. And she didn't say this to me, but she was puzzled. She was thinking, I wonder why is Barry calling me? I said, Mrs. Patrick, I want to see how you feel right now. I said, when you left today, you were upset about some things, and I just wanted to let you know I was thinking about you. And she said, oh, Barry, I'm fine. I said, well, we're family, so I had to call you like that, you know. But I confused it because she didn't know why is this guy calling me. But that's how it was. And every holiday and Mother's Day, I would call Mrs. Patrick because that's where she was, my mother. I can say this as an alumnus of Tuskegee University and as an employee like she was. She well represented the university. And the university is blessed to have had Mrs. Patrick. And you've all heard the phrase, TU, you know. What TU knows, Mrs. Willie Patrick represented that university. Mrs. Patrick is my mother, and she's looking down on me today. And I will say this right now, Mrs. Patrick, I will see you in the morning. I love you.
To Reverend Manuel and to all of the ministers of the gospel and to all of the members of the wonderful Patrick family, just wave your hand wherever you are. Wherever you are, let's show them some love. Let's put our hands together and let them know that we are with them and we appreciate them. And Mother Patrick is at rest, is at rest. On behalf of our mayor, the Honorable Tony Haygood, and members of the City Council, and as the District 2 Council, I've been asked to present a resolution. Bernie, I want to thank you for calling me and letting me know that Mother had gone home. Because you know your father, Zolly Patrick, and my dad, they were cut buddies. And the entire Patrick family, Chief, you know how much we all grew up together and appreciated each other. First of all, before we go any further, all of you all who are in law enforcement, including our Sheriff Bronson and all of the members of the police department, now is a proper time for us to give a salute to Mother Patrick. And to all of those of you who think you know how to play basketball and who are great sports, let's let Brother Bernie Patrick know how much we appreciate him by just waving our hands. Lake Snakes and all of us. But it was Bernie Patrick who broke Florida A&M's heart by catching that winning touchdown and winning and representing Tuskegee University. Chief Patrick, thank you so much for your service, and to all other members of the Patrick family. On behalf of the city of Tuskegee, whereas Mrs. Willie Mae Patrick, on April 13th, made her transition from her earthly home to her heavenly home. And whereas Mrs. Willie Mae Patrick is a matriarch of that grand and outstanding Patrick family. Whereas on behalf of the citizens of Tuskegee, Alabama, we express our sincerest sympathy and our sincerest best wishes to the Patrick family and hereby proclaim this day as an official day of mourning on behalf of the Patrick family. In witness whereof, I have hereunto set my hand and cause the seal of the great city of Tuskegee to be affixed. May she rest in peace. Good night, Mother Patrick. We'll see you in the morning.
You coming over?
All right.
I was going to bring the mic to you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I
said I wasn't going to say anything like about this, but Miss Patrick was so close to us. And every time you call her or see her, she always had this wonderful smile. She couldn't do anything else but smile, it seemed like to me. She never had a frustrating word to say to you when you talked to her. It was always something encouraging. But I'm going to do, this is my tribute to Miss Willie Mae. You had a wonderful mother, one who never really grew old. Her smile was made of sunshine, and her heart was solid gold. Her eyes were as bright as shining stars, and in her cheeks, fair roses you see. You had a wonderful mother. That's the way it always will be. But take heed, because she's still keeping an eye on all of you. So let's make sure she will like what she sees. It's from a poem entitled, You Had a Wonderful Mother, and the author is unknown. Miss Willie Mae was a warm, soft-spoken woman, always with a smile that was so encouraging. And as I speak about her as a member of the church where I grew up, she was at Greater Friendship Missionary Baptist Church for over 84 years. I know this because my mother told me she was there when she went there, and she was 12 years old when she joined Greater Friendship, so Ms. Willie Mae had to be there over 84 years. She was a fully devoted follower of Jesus, faithful in worship, fellowship, and serving in the church's ministries. She was a generous giver of her offerings, her time, and her talent until her health failed. Miss Willie Mae was a faithful witness of the gospel to anyone and everyone. She was a servant, and she knew that working for God came with a great reward, both here on earth and in a city called heaven. There's a place beyond the clouds, beyond the moon, it's a city I'm going soon, and it's filled with so much joy and happiness. It's a city called heaven. There's a place beyond the clouds, beyond the moon. It's a city we're going soon, and it's filled with much joy and happiness. It's a city called heaven. Don't you wanna go to heaven, heaven? You don't have to die, you don't have to die no more. Don't you wanna go to heaven? Oh, heaven, it's a city called heaven. Oh, yes, it's a city called heaven.
Thank you, Sister Deborah. And we thank everyone who has taken part in this celebration today. I want to draw your attention today to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. That is the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. And it reads this way. Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and indeed he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, "Rejoice." So they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth that is found in your word. We thank you for the comfort and also for the challenge of the truth of the word of God. We ask, Father, that during this time as we speak a word into the hearing of not only this bereaving family, but all of those who have come to mourn and celebrate, that, Father, you would make eternity real to all of them and that you will show them the path that they must go. How do we move on from times like this? We move on hand in hand with you, Lord. So God, guide us and keep us. Help us to have understanding. And Lord, I ask that you would allow your spirit to work through me for your glory, that this body of Christ, this congregation that is here underneath your heaven, that God, we will be edified and you, Holy Father, will be glorified. Thank you, Father, for Jesus. Thank you for Mama Patrick. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus of Nazareth was crucified. I know typically we get to the end of the sermon and talk about that, but I want to start there. Jesus of Nazareth was crucified. He was buried in a borrowed tomb, and he arose from the dead to bring eternal life into this world. How do we know? Because there were witnesses. The witnesses told their stories, and the stories were written down for you and I. One witness in particular was a woman named Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene was particularly grateful to Jesus because she was possessed by seven spirits that Jesus cast from her. She is listed as one of the women who financially supported his earthly ministry. But the depth of her devotion is greatest during the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. In our text today, Mary encounters the risen Lord and is instructed to deliver a message to his disciples. From that message, I want to speak from a thought. Meet me in Galilee. Meet me in Galilee. Three witnesses I want to share with you today, and we will conclude. The first is the witness of the crucifixion. According to the Gospel of John, chapter 19, verse 25, it says, "Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother, his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene." Mary Magdalene was there to witness the darkest moment in the life of Jesus. She was there. She saw it all. She witnessed the nails in his hands and his feet. She witnessed the piercing of his side when blood and water came running down. She witnessed the humiliation as Jesus was stripped and guards cast lots for his clothing. She witnessed the mockery by the religious leaders. Mary witnessed the moment the sins of the world were placed on her Savior, and he cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? She witnessed the salvation of a thief who said, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Mary witnessed the moment, the very moment that Jesus gave up the ghost, and she didn't leave. She didn't turn away. Mary counted every bit of the cost of her salvation. Jesus had delivered her from a personal darkness, and she didn't abandon him in his darkness either. We must all stand at the cross. We must all stay there with Jesus and witness his great suffering for our sins. Every one of us must have an eyewitness account. Not an eyewitness as in with your physical eye, but I, as a person, am able to witness that I once was blind, but now I can see. Not this eyewitness of I saw it myself, but that I looked into my life and I saw that I needed a Savior. I, as a person, stand witness of the fact that every day of my life, I wake up and I still need a Savior. At some point early in her life, Mama Patrick stood witness to her need for deliverance. Christ was crucified, and she had the courage to look on him. What do you mean, Pastor? She had the courage to look at his brokenness in hearing the story about his crucifixion. She had the courage to hear this good news and realize that the news was so good because her plight in this life was so bad. What do you mean? I mean this. Sin is a one-way ticket to eternal destruction. If we never stand at the base of the cross and allow Jesus to take our sins away, we will never be forgiven by God. We will never meet Jesus in Galilee. Mama Patrick heard the gospel, and she knew that she needed a Savior. Just like Mary Magdalene, she knew she wasn't perfect and needed the grace of God in order to make it in. She knew Jesus was the only one qualified to bear her burdens, and she knew the gravity and the weight of his sacrifice, and she did not leave the cross even when they were taking his body down off the cross. Mama Patrick, a long time ago, made this same appointment with Jesus as she marched through this life to meet him in Galilee. The second witness I want to share with you today is the witness of the resurrection. Matthew chapter 28 and 1, which was read to you earlier, was it says this: Now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. Because of the timing and the circumstances of Jesus' crucifixion, his body wasn't properly prepared for burial. You see, Sabbath began at sundown on Friday, and he died on Friday. And during Sabbath, the people could not do any type of work. As a result, Jesus' body could not be embalmed until Sabbath ended on Sunday morning. Mary Magdalene got up early Sunday morning and headed to the tomb with the intent of preparing the body of Jesus for burial. But when she arrived, she became a witness of the resurrection. You see, Mary witnessed an earthquake that morning. She witnessed an angel of God who rolled a stone away and sat down there at the entrance of the tomb. She witnessed guards that were supposed to be keeping people out so they wouldn't steal the body of Jesus, these very same guards lying on the ground like dead men. Mary received confirmation of the resurrection of Jesus from an angel himself. But the angel said to her, "Woman, do not be afraid. For I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And indeed, he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you."
Jesus was crucified on Friday, but he was not there at the tomb on Sunday. He was risen. A new day had dawned, and the words Jesus had spoke to all of his disciples and followers had been confirmed. He had risen just as he said. There's something special about Sunday morning. When the Apostle John was out there on the Isle of Patmos in the book of the Revelation, and I thank God that C.P. Noble read from the Revelation, he said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. You have to understand this is significant because I know that we talk about Sabbath being holy and Sabbath is Saturday, but that Lord's day, the day that the Lord had risen from the grave, became prominent in the eyes of Christians. That's why we have church on Sunday. We have church every week on getting up morning. We have church every Sunday in celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Each week around the world, believers all over the place worship and bear witness to the resurrection of Jesus. Our very presence among the saints of God is a witness. In my mind's eye, I can see Mama Patrick in worship. I can see her anchored to her hope in Jesus, sitting on the third pew in the second seat from the middle. I know exactly where she is in my mind's eye. This woman was always in worship. I can see her sway as the choir began to sing. I can see her close her eyes in silent contemplation as she was listening to the word of God. And she took time and she made effort to come to worship as it was her witness of the eternal life she had received in Christ Jesus. Each Sunday morning was a checkup in preparation for a meeting that she could not miss. She had to go and make some changes in her life. She had to walk this world because she had a meeting with him in Galilee. The last witness is the witness of the world. And I want to go back to Matthew 28, verses 8 through 10. And it says this. So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, rejoice. Somebody say, rejoice. So they came and held him by the feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee, and there they will see me. Mary Magdalene witnessed the crucifixion, and she was a witness of the resurrection. And now she has been tasked with a witness to the world. Jesus said, rejoice. And then he said, go tell my brethren. The ultimate expression of the life of a Christian is their witness. It is their ability to fulfill the commandment of a risen Savior who has delivered us all and set us free. This is the pinnacle of our faith. It is the ultimate expression of the will of God for his church. How do I know this? The word of God says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe whatsoever things I have taught you, and lo, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. But let me tell you something. Before Jesus uttered these words in Matthew chapter 28, verses 8, 19 through 20, before he gave us what is called the Great Commission, Mary Magdalene was the first person he told to go tell. He told this woman who was there to witness his resurrection to go tell my disciples to meet me in Galilee. In the journey of Sister Patrick's life, she was always pointing to a meeting in Galilee. Some of y'all think that this is just a time that we look at her death, but no, she was making an appointment that had already been determined before the foundations of the world, that there was going to be a day that she would meet her Savior if she gave her life to Jesus Christ. She is on her way to her meeting in Galilee. She was always marching toward this meeting with Jesus. Even when her health began to fail, even when time began to ravage her body and she began to not have all of the abilities that she had in her younger days, she never lost focus and she never lost hope in her meeting in Galilee. I remember last month we had the singing pastors in concert, and I remember Dr. C.P. Noble invited us pastors to sing two selections, and I know Deacon Patrick told me that during the singing pastors, he was there with his mother and he turned on the singing pastors on his phone so she could watch it, and though she had been unresponsive, she responded. It's something about when she heard the praises of God going up. It's something when she realized that somebody was singing and talking about her Jesus, that she recognized, my meeting is coming up sometime soon. My meeting is going to happen, and I'm going to go to Galilee. And if you've been watching her, if you've been following her, if you've been loving her and supporting her, thank you so much for caring for Mama Patrick so that she can make the transition to go and meet the Savior, not in the physical Galilee that's somewhere across the ocean, but in that eternal Galilee, that place where there is no more weeping and no more sorrow, in that place where there is no more pain, in that place where you have nothing but joy, joy, joy every day from now until eternity. I don't know about you, but I can't wait for my opportunity to meet the Lord in Galilee. I can't wait for my chance to be with my Savior. I can't wait to be able to see Mama Patrick again. I can't wait. And I challenge you, if you have not made your appointment, don't put it off. We live in some dangerous times. We live in some COVID times. Tomorrow is not promised for any of us. If you have not made that decision, you need to make an appointment to meet the Lord. And I know this is a home-going service, but I'm going to tell you right now, where two or three are gathered together, he is there in the midst. The doors of the church are open. And if you have not made Jesus Christ your choice, I just want to give you that opportunity right now. Or maybe you stepped so far away from God that you just don't believe he has you written down in his ledger to have that meeting with him. If you have not made that choice, I want to give you that chance. Bow your heads. Father, I do not know. I cannot tell. I cannot call the status of eternity with every person that is here. But God, you see our hearts. You see the inner workings of our souls. You even tell us in your word, you know our thoughts are very far off. And I just believe somebody here is thinking about eternity. And unfortunately, whether we make the appointment with you or not, we're going to meet eternity. But I just believe for all of us, we'd much rather meet it in the face of a smiling Savior than in the condition of eternal destruction. And so, God, I pray for every soul that is here under the sound of my voice. I pray for every person that is wrestling right now with the Holy Spirit, every person that is trying to come to grips with, is it all right for me to make this profession in front of everybody else? I pray that you give them this chance right now and that they would have the courage to be like Mary Magdalene, to meet you at the foot of the cross, to stay there until they have seen what you have done for them, to witness your resurrection in their lives, and to grow to be a witness to the world. And so if you're here and you have not made that decision with every eye still closed, it's just you and me, I invite you right now to just raise your hand. We don't have to ask you to come up to the front. We don't have to ask you to do anything other than raise your hand to acknowledge that you want to commit your life to Jesus. If that's you, then let me pray even more with you. God, I thank you for the souls that have lifted their hands. I thank you for the people who have had the courage to step forward. I pray, Father, that you will seal them to the day of redemption by your Holy Spirit. And let us have the same testimony at our home going as Sister Patrick, that we know that we'll be in glory, that someone will be able to stand over us in our time and say, I know that that individual, that man, that woman, that child is going to be in heaven because I know they made Jesus Christ their choice. Be with this family. Comfort and strengthen them. provide for their every need, financial, physical, emotional, mental, Lord, all of their health, their spiritual health, their well-being. Put a hedge of protection around them from the negative thoughts that will haunt them in the midnight hour. And help them to shed tears, but tears of joy and of hope and expectation. We give you glory, we give you honor, and we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. It is time for the committal. And we ask that you would give us your attention during this solemn moment. Bowing in humble submission to the will of our Heavenly Father, who hath taken to himself the soul of our deceased sister, we do therefore commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the general resurrection in the last day and the life of the world to come, through our Lord Jesus, who shall come in majesty and power to judge the quick and the dead, when corruptible bodies of those who sleep in him shall be made like unto his own glorious body. May we, with all those who have died in the faith, rise with eternal glory for his name's sake. Amen. Join me, please, as we share with you the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.
Prayer, and all other expressions of love and kindness shown during their time of bereavement. Special thanks to the Magnolia Haven Health and Rehabilitation Center, East Alabama Medical Center, and Encompass Hospice Care. May God continue to richly bless you. This is from the family. Family members, on behalf of the entire staff of McKenzie's Funeral Home, I would like to thank you for this opportunity to serve you during your time of bereavement. And today, as a final tribute to Ms. Patrick, if you would please turn your attention to your right. It's written in Psalms 55:6 that, oh, if I had wings like a dove, for then I would fly away and be at rest. So today, in the spirit of Ms. Willie Mae Patrick, we release the dove. And at this time, this is going to conclude the service here for Ms. Patrick. We're going to ask that once we depart from the graveside, and as we're greeting each other, that we greet each other with the protocols that we've all been asked to use, which is either a fist bump or an elbow bump instead of our customary hugs and kisses. Thank you. And also, at this time, may we have some young ladies that would like to serve as flower bearers, please.
Hear the worshipers! Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go.
It's to our God.
Every word of worship.
With one accord.
is due our God.